being parted. After mutual exchange of good wishes, in due time, Haridwar was reached. Haridwar, as the name suggests, is the gateway to the great shrines of the Himalaya. Here the pilgrims stayed for 2 days. It is most delightful to visit the banks of Ganga, where congregate sannyasins, sannyasinis, sadhus, bhaktas, brahmins, pious mothers, all busy with bath, ablution, sandhya, prayers and worship. O Ram, thou art clearly manifested these holy things. Now the journey on the Himalayas has come. Haridwar by the place. There it starts. Up and up, Ramdas and Ramkinkar mounted and reached the place called Rishikesh. Rishikesh is a very beautiful place. The scene from the banks of the holy Ganga are simply charming. Here the lofty peaks of mountains are dimly visible at a distance, covered over with white mist, kissing as they do the rolling waves of clouds that hang over them. A nearer gaze presents to the eye high gigantic rocks with dense forest, a mixture of green, yellow and red hues of leaves, foliage and blossoms. A still nearer view shows the crystal water of the holy Ganga that flows in all calmness and majesty, disclosing in her bosom huge pieces of rock which are rushing torrents. Torrent had pulled down in days of yore and made round and smooth. O Ram, thou art sublime. On one side of the great river are seen a number of small thatcher huts, neat and clean, ashrams of sannyasis. Ramkinkar took Ramdas into one of these huts. The interior of the hut was fitted with the simplest furniture, a bamboo cot, two posts of which formed the pillar of the hut himself, on which was spread a deer skin, a kumbal, a blanket lying on the folds at the foot of it. A venerable old sannyasi was sweating upon the deer skin. On a peg was hanging his kamandal, made of a black shell. Except a small piece of cloth and a spare kaupeen, which were drying in the sun outside, he had no other clothing. On the sandy floor of the hut was a bamboo mat, and in a corner were two black stones, one big and the other small, for crushing almonds and such other hard eatables having shells to break. There was a calm and peaceful look upon the countenance of the sage. He welcomed Ramkinkar and Ramdas with a cheerful smile, and they started themselves on the mat after prostrating at the feet of the Mahatma. He offered some cardamoms to the guests and had a simple and childlike talk with them about saints who would be found in the thick forest on the opposite bank of the Ganges, unexplored by ordinary men, where for a number of years they might be performing tapasya. His beautiful advice to Ramdas was to remain as long as possible for his sadhana in solitude, than which there is no better means of control of the mind. This is the message from this. Apart from the beautiful scene, evolved souls who have settled down there, from their own experience, what they have enjoyed, they are sharing. There is a solitude. We don't interact with anybody.
And they don't possess anything. That's what they are looking at. They don't possess anything.
They don't possess anything. Simple living, contented, not worried about tomorrow. Only concentrating on God thought in their own way. Solitude. So this chapter gives us something about the great tapasya they are. O Ram, it was thyself in all thy glory that Ramdas met under the same simple roof. One thing more, the sage was very fond of birds. He would not miss to share his food with them every day. They would wait for their share on the trees outside the hut. He talked very lovingly of them. After coming out, Ramkinkar and Ramdas wandered on the banks of Mother Ganga, where they saw a number of sannyasis clad in orange robes, their faces beaming with a cheerful light. They had all come out of their usual morning bath in the holy waters. Ramdas, during his stay in Rishikesh, had occupied the mud platform around the banyan tree on the bank of the river, close to the hut of a Mahatma. The sage was also very kind to Ramdas. His hobby was to feed cows and monkeys, who would always be crowding around his hut. In order to feed them, he would be begging in the bazaar and secure footsteps and grass. He was finding a peculiar pleasure in childishly dancing with monkeys, running after them, making strange noises, all in glee and sport. His face was bright, and his greenish eyes would twinkle always with watery tenderness. Under the same tree, there was also a blind sadhu, who had a good voice, which he made right use of by singing the glory of Ram. 3 days were spent here in our place, in all peace and happiness. Ramshankar was kind enough to attend to Ramdas's food. There are 2 big anakshetras in Rishikesh, which usually furnished food to all the sannyasis. Of these kshetras, one was started by the great Mahatma by name Kali Kamliwala, who is now in Mahasamadhi. On these mountains and among sadhus, his blessed name is on the lips of all. With his influence, he has induced the wealthy merchants of Bombay and other places to open it every 10 to 15 miles on the high hills, a dharmshala in which sadhavat or footsteps are distributed free to all sadhu pilgrims who hold chits with which they are provided at Rishikesh. Ramshankar secured these chits for Ramdas at Rishikesh. Thus ends the first step. Message is about the simple, humble, contented living of spiritual aspirants. How solitude helps. When we keep on pondering over it, we find the solitude helps because you don't react, you don't see an individual, you don't see a person, you don't interact. When you interact, reaction will come. He will ask about his previous, where are you coming from? Finished, you know. You are back again to your old life. That is why solitude, the more we think about it, when at the same time they are not within the cage, they are one with the nature. You are dealing with the nature, you are interacting with the nature, you are enjoying the nature. And here it is not sightseeing, you are seeing the wondrous way in which God is before us. There is a beautiful quotation of Papa. Where he talks about this nature.
June.
The book placed before us.
June
letter. June issue. The nature we should not forget. It is the one which is offering us that the quotation is very, very appealing. Nature is presented before us. It's a beautiful book placed before us. We have the magnificent book of nature spread before us. A picture of unsurpassing beauty and charm. The spontaneous and blissful self-expression of the indwelling God. Let us look at it, read in it the glorious presentation and the varied activity of the Vedas. Look on the infinite play of the Infinite One, and by deep absorption into the Vedas, enjoy immortal joy. This is the goal. All else is ephemeral, not worth striving for. So we have the magnificent book of nature spread out. That is what we found in this Himalayan journey. The second chapter. On the 4th day, they started on their journey higher on the hills. As they climbed higher and higher, the scenes and landscapes they saw were found to be simply enchanting. On the right, the sacred Ganga was rushing downhill in all her glory. On the left, high rocky hills, full of foliage and trees, presented at once a thrilling and absorbing sight. The very air there was charged with the divine presence of Ram. The far off hills and valleys, the varied hue, sky in which the white fleecy clouds assumed fantastic shapes, the snow-clapped mountains, hundreds of miles away up, dazzling in the rays of the sun, as though they were covered with sheets of silver. All these constituted, indeed, an imposing sight. Oh, the charm of the scene, O Ram, poor Ramdas cannot find adequate words to describe the grandeur, the beauty, the wonderful glory of the sight that met his bewildering gaze. As he walked on, he drank deeper and deeper of the splendor of Ram's infinity and was lost to the intoxication of it all. O Ram, thy kindness to thy slave is really unbounded. From day to day, both Ramkinkar and Ramdas walked on at a high speed. Ramdas felt no fatigue, no pain, no discomfort of any kind. He was as fresh as ever. It was all due to Ram's grace, whose name was always on his lips. That mountain after mountain was traversed, and as they climbed on, grander and newer scenes presented themselves before their wondering sight. It was a journey in the land of enchantment. It was all a bewitching dream full of the glory and greatness of Ram. There Ram exhibits his marvelous powers. He is a mighty conjurer. Vision after vision dances and flits before your eyes, and unconsciously you fall into the subtle charm and spell of this great magician. You forget what you are and where you are. You are simply absorbed and lost in the surroundings like a wisp of smoke in a hurricane. Ramdas was walking at high speed. Nay, he was veritably flying. Even the difficult ascents were scaled in no time. Most of the time, he was unconscious of his body. His mind was entirely merged in Ram, whom alone appeared to him in those enchanting scenes. Here we clearly understand, even while opening the eyes, one can merge with Ram. Sense of individuality is totally absent there. That is why you are dancing, you know. Higher and higher climbed the indefatigable pilgrims. Ramkinkar, who had a very heavy bundle to carry, complained of Ramdas's running speed, since he could not keep pace with him. But Ramdas was not really his own master. Ram was his master. At a certain place they missed each other, causing anxiety to both, but however Ram brought them together at a stage called Rudra Prayag. Thousands of pilgrims are every year ascending these hills, and during this season, from March to June, a regular stream of people are going up and coming down the hills. All the pilgrims, sadhus and others whom Ramdas met on the way were very kind to him. Some rich merchants from cities like Bombay were very kind, because Ram is kind, all are kind. Ram is all in all. Mountains are peopled by hill tribes, a fair complexion and well-built trees. They live by cultivation and cattle and goat breeding. Naturally, their lives were simple. Their faith in God is very great. Ram Ram is always on their lips. If you talk to them, they will tell you with a glow of pride, that they are the descendants of the rishis that lived in those hills. Their clothing is wholly made of wool. Males wear long woolen coats and drawers and black caps, and women rough blankets in place of saris. These blankets are prepared there out of wool, heated by the sheep they tend. To the foodstuffs and clothing, two essentials of life are the produce of their own labor. Even while walking from place to place, every man and woman carries a quantity of wool, which he or she is spinning on the way. They have simple pitch looms on which they weave the yarn into cloth. Since their mode of life is free from the baneful touch of modern civilization, they live simple, pure, honest, pious lives. It's purely a need-based life. So consumerism has not stepped in. Desires are not popping up. Simple. What is needed, God provides, they are satisfied. at different stages of the journey over the hills, under trees or in small huts or caves are seen, sadhus engaged in austerity. To seek their company and remain there forever, ever so small period, is a great privilege. The society of a sadhu is a much needed bath of the mind. The pure atmosphere he creates around him by his meditation is the river in which the mind bathes and is purged off evil thoughts and impressions. That means when we go to Himalayas, we must find time to spend time with them, not seeing them and then just coming back. Then only we are really making use of the facilities there. Not only we are charmed by their austerity, any word uttered by them is precious to us in our spiritual journey. Because they are ever reveling in that, no? It is not a, they are full timers, unlike us. Due to their explanation, Papa, you know, the pure society of a sage is a much needed bath for the mind. The pure atmosphere he creates around him by his meditation is the river in which the mind bathes and is purged of evil thoughts and impressions. In one of the narratives we remember now, the person who narrated, you know, he along with one friend, they were going up the hills, Himalayas. He met a young sadhu, surrounded by so many devotees. He was sharing some thoughts about some Upanishad. Very calm, quiet. His face itself was gleaming with joy. He was enjoying what he was sharing. That is one part. In the meantime, somebody came, one lady also came. They were also devotees, as there is no doubt. But they were coming with some questions. Through that narrative, we are taught we should not go with questions. We just hear. But thoughts, questions are also relevant because we are telling them, we are sharing with these experiences you because of this question, not all. So she asked whether you believe in the personal aspect or impersonal aspect of God. My guru, she said, my guru emphasizes on the impersonal aspect. Immediately, the sadhu replied, that was in Malayalam, right? He said, whether it is personal or impersonal, what is more important is the other one, God. He is there as, we all have forms, you know. Why should we deny forms to him? We know that the indwelling reality is there, but the indwelling reality cannot be known without a form. But at the same time, he is not to be limited to the form. So, it is not a question of whether murtamano or murtamano, whether it is personal or impersonal. And then, there is nothing called my guru. Those who have got that inner light, you know, he is the guru. Who is enjoying the inner light, he is from the world. So there is no question of my guru or your guru. He is a guru for all. This narrative is a big book. There are so many things, you know, we find. Then immediately she is apologizing. She says, no, I shouldn't have. No, no, that's it. Think about it. Murtamano, amurtamano. These are all. Why is he in intellectual journey? He is there. He is there in the form. He is there. He is formless. Though formless, he is expressing through the form. Simple, you know. We need not break our head. And Guru is Normally, Papa used to be awake. Simple here. Ullil Varicham Lonandu. Those who are conscious of their inner life. And he is the guru for all. He radiates. He doesn't go and preach. He doesn't go and say, I am, you should do this, you should do that. He is very present, you know. He is the inner light in him touches the inner light in him. So these are all the things, you know. The beauty of the place, you know, is the land of rishis. Nowadays, wherever you go in Himalaya, you will find Devaloka. Of course, these people have gone and put plastic and so many things, you know, we have spoiled it. But it is still called Devaloka. Entry to Devaloka. So the at different stages, the pure atmosphere he creates around him by his meditation is the river in which the mind bathes and is purged of evil thoughts and impressions. Upon these sacred hills of the ashram of such famous saints as Narada and Agastya Muni, there is a place called Pandugesha, where the Pandavas are said to have halted for some time during their journey to Kailas. There is a temple here and some old inscriptions upon plates of copper. The first place visited by Ramdas and Ramkinkar on the heights was Triyugi Narayan. The ascent to this spot was sharp and steep, surrounded by hills covered with snow. Then after descending from distance, another chain of hills was mounted. Here the path was narrow, rugged, dangerous, frail. Rickety bridges had to be crossed. At three places, large tracts of snow had to be traversed. On account of the perilous nature of the path, every year many pilgrims are reported to have slipped down the cliffs and been washed away. That means, you know, you may not see it when I show you. The path is like this, edge of, and here, straight decline, 1000 feet, 1500 feet, steep, is a deep incline, downward in the air. And then Ganga is way. Any slip, then, so, now here, he puts Ram on test. At a certain stage in the middle of the ascent, Ramdas was sitting on the path awaiting Ramkinkar. That was the edge of a cliff and the river was flowing far below. The path was narrow. A girl of about 16 years, full of energy and activity, was coming down on her return journey. It was a sharp descent. Her pace was rapid and the sharp downhill path only accelerated her speed, and in spite of herself, she was running down at uncontrollable velocity. Down, down, down she came. She was excited. Her face was flushed. She knew she was being drawn down automatically. It was beyond her power to control herself. Instead of running towards the hillside, she was staggering down to the edge of the path, the very bow of a precipice. Ramdas watched the scene with breathless suspense. He was silently calling upon Ram to save her. Ram alone could, and none else. Now she came to the edge. With a superhuman effort, controlled herself. She had come to the very brink. Part of her left foot was out of the edge.
Except that.
After one year, he is writing this. In Patipandavati. Now the scene is before us. She had come to the very brink. Part of her left foot was out of the... Oh, Ram! How terrible a condition! Ram, thy name be glorified. Ramdas looks and sees the girl falling on the path right across, uttering, Ram, Ram, Ram. Saved. Ram saved her. She got up, did not wait a minute, but continued her walk further down. Dauntless girl. What a marvelous faith in Ram this time. The other was the case of an old woman who gave up her body in the basket in which she was being carried by a sturdy mountaineer who was specially engaged in the purpose. at certain stages in the journey, the carrier would lower down his burden for relief, and the last time he did so, it happened to be near the place where Ramkankar and Ramdas were resting. The bearer, as usual with him, lowered the basket on a rock, asked the old mother to step out of the basket for some time, but receiving no reply, the hillman peeped into the basket, and a cry of surprise and pain started. The poor woman is gone. He exclaimed, "O Ram, thy will be done." In one place, saving her life. And under perilous, here it is relatively safer, no? But here the death takes it. This is the thing, you know, he approaches the poor. "O Ram, thy will be done." Can be this way, that way. Then walking higher and higher, Ramdas and his kind guide eventually reached Kedarnath. This was indeed a grand place. It was plain land in the midst of high towering mountains covered with snow. The cold air was extremely severe. "O Ram, thy kindness to thy slave was so great that thou had made him almost proof against cold." And the last chapter went, Himalayan. In Kedarnath, Ramdas performed a most difficult feat, all the way around the place. He ascended one of the surrounding high rocks covered with snow. Of course, Ramkankar followed him. While going up, they had to do so by holding the high, rough grass that grew on the hill. They must be on all fours, you know. It was a steep ascent. For nearly half the way, Ramkankar accompanied him. Then he refused to go higher up with Ramdas, both on account of the cold and the danger of slipping down. Meanwhile, Ramdas, who had surrendered himself into the hands of Ram, mounted higher and higher until he reached the summit of the hill and touched its narrow conical peak. As he touched the top, he gave a cry of triumph at the name of Sri Ram. He uttered at the top voice, "Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. O Ram, what a glorious being thou art." So he was putting Ram into test. You know. Now descent was most perilous. An unguarded step or a slight slip meant a headlong fall and certain destruction of the body. However, when Ram guided worried the fear, "What danger cannot be faced boldly?" He slowly crept down, may slip down the hill. While doing so, it began to rain. White solid globules of snow. He had ascended without any warm clothing, but by Ram's grace he felt neither cold nor fear. At last Ram brought him safe to the base of the rock. It took 5 hours to accomplish this ascent. The height of the hill might have been over a mile. Going to the source of the river Mandagini, it starts at this place where the snow melts and flows down. He took his bath. The water was of course very, very cold, but cold can affect him. What cold can affect him when Ram protects? In Kedarnath there is a temple, some shops, residences. A day stay. He doesn't explain anything about Kedarnath temple. You will find better in other words, no? A day stay, and he on the advice of Ramkankar travelled onwards. After descending of some miles, the pilgrims commenced to walk upon another chain of mountains. Higher and higher again they climbed. Again glorious, enchanting landscapes and scenes met their eyes. At the foot of a hill, they came upon a resting place where there was a small tank called Gauri Kund, where in hot water through a spring is collected. There was also another tank in which the water was yellow in color. From there, he and Ramkankar started on their upward journey. Just imagine, he was so first telling us he used to go there every day. Even now it is there. That hot spring. He says a bath in that, you know, removes everything, all pain. There, God has provided a hot spring. And the other one, colored one, is it? Sulfur. because it helps your skin also. Gandham. Gandham is not a sulfur law. Gandham. Sulfur basis. There was also another tank in which the water was yellow in color. From there, he and Ramkinkar started on their upward journey. Miles and miles of ascent were traversed. The pathway now was not so bad as what was left with Karana. For days and days, they walked on, and at last near the place called Badrinath or Badrinarayan. While they were at about half a mile from the place, they sat down on the path, looked at the Badrinath mountains. The sight was bewitching. To describe the scene, poor pen of Ramdas is quite inadequate and unfit. As he gazed on, he for a time lost body consciousness, became one with the tall mountain in the midst of which he was sitting. Badrinath is the source of the river Alagananda. While going up these heights of three or four places, the pilgrims had to cross wide tracts of snow. He travelled over them with naked feet. These tracts of snow are glaciers. Below the surface of these vast cakes of snow, the flowing water in heavy torrents, downhill to meet the river below. It is said that many pilgrims, while walking on their surface, have been sucked down by the torrent, some thin layer of snow giving way beneath their feet. The story is current that a wealthy merchant of Bombay, while being carried on a dolly or cradle-like conveyance by four strong men, was drowned and lost in the swift current below. Badrinath was reached. It is a flat valley surrounded on all sides by high mountains like Kedarnath, and here stands the temple of Badrinarayan in white marble. At this place also there was a tank containing hot water, received from a hot spring running down the hill. All the pilgrims bathed in this tank. The cold was very intense, but Ram was kind and gracious at the same time. Ramdas did not feel the rigor of the cold very much. He had some difficulty in gaining entrance to the temple for the darshan of Badrinarayan, as there was a heavy rush of pilgrims at the front door. But some sickly people were permitted to get in by a narrow side door, at which two pandas of Brahmins were set to watch. He sought entrance here. One of the pandas said, "If you are sick, you can come in." "No, Ramdas is not sick," replied Ramdas. "Then pretend that you are sick if you are not," suggested that pandas. "Never," returned. "He does not want the darshan of Badrinath by telling a lie. It is against the command of Ram." Saying that, he turned away from the place. But the kind Pandaji at once, grasping his hand, took him inside, getting the darshan of Badrinath, gave him also some prasad. "O Ram, thou art testing thy slave in various ways." Remaining in Badrinath for a day, Sadhu started on their return journey. After several days' walk, they came to a place called Ramnagar, whence the railway line starts running southward. In all, the distance travelled over the Himalayas was 400 miles. He completed in 30 minutes, no? And the time taken for the Haridwaram was 40 days. Ramnagar, as the name suggests, is a blessed place. Charity is the ideal of the people there. Near the railway station, there is a dispensary worked by the Congress volunteers for the benefit of aging pilgrims. Hundreds of pilgrims are every day receiving aid from the dispensary. Arrangements by well-to-do citizens are made for feeding sadhus and poor pilgrims. People of the place are kind and hospitable. For his part, Ramdas must say the same with regard to all parts of India. Wherever he travelled, Ram was uniformly kind to him in all his travels, because he had started on his travel at the bidding of Ram alone. Not planned by him, at the bidding of Ram alone. At Ramnagar, he and Ramkinkar got into the train proceeding to Mathura, which they reached in due time. Here Ramkinkar was taken ill, proposed to return to Jhansi. During all the time he was with Ramdas, Ramkinkar was more than a mother to him. He took every care of him. It was all Ram's wish that such a friend should leave him. Accordingly, Ramkinkar left Mathura for Jhansi. Ramdas was now alone, only for a few minutes, for Ram had another sadhu ready at the dharmashala while they were halting to take him up. So the we have covered the Himalayas now. So the points, no? One is the we have the magnificent book of nature spread out before us. The picture of unsurpassing beauty and charm. The spontaneous and blissful self-expression of the indwelling God. Indwelling God. Let us look at it, read in it, the glorious presentation and the varied activity of the world. Look on the infinite play of the Infinite One. And by deep absorption into the mirror, universal being, that's what happened in his faith. Enjoy immortal joy. This is the goal. All else is ephemeral, not worth striving for. Another one was solitude. The advantage of solitude. The simple living habits of ascetics and devotees. A need rooted in need based life. And the presence of their presence of such evolved souls, you know. There will be something for us to learn, not necessarily through verbal expressions, also through verbal expressions. We are not only seeing their austerities, you know, not only their simple and humble living, but everywhere he says the joy and the blissful. That means how they are reveling in that moment. That is why it's called development. Land of the sheep. Papa is transporting us. Everybody may not be able to go to Himalaya. Even if we go, we may not be able to enjoy this. But now mentally he is making us to enjoy this. And make, reminding us, it is possible. You bring all these in your mind. And wherever you go, you will see that. The fifth description is so vivid. Because everything has touched his heart. You are enjoying every moment. And mind you, all these words have come after 1.5 years. Ah, 400 miles in 40 days. 400 miles on foot in 40 days is nothing to fall back upon. Only relying on Ram. Tell us something about the reliance on Ram. We just close the book and then start thinking about it. No? We travel again with him through the Himalayas. That means even when we go open, probably everybody thought, you know, only through an inward journey we can have, yeah, it is right, agreed. Indwelling God can be experienced only through inward journey. But he is also all pervading, you know. Everybody will remember, Papa keeps on bringing these two words together. Indwelling and outer way. So with that perspective, when he looks at the whole, he only sees him. We also go, we do the sightseeing, we take photographs, we, you know, at times jump, we feel ecstasy. Everything is alright, but we see it as an object. We don't associate with God's bounteous gifts. This is a lesson for all of us. This is the subtle message he gives us. Unsurpassable beauty and charm. Nobody will be able to bring it up. There are in many areas in Himalaya there are only pine trees. You know, from the pine tree, a yellow flower, no? Yellow, you can call it a flower or fruit or whatever you call it. That is, the trees drop it. And a stage comes only as if it is a carpet, you know, later. Nothing else. Only trees, no other trees. And there will be a walking track. Just to see the both sides, you know, tremendous. We can't reach the other end. Because nowadays they are replacing this pine tree because no other tree will grow under a pine tree. And pine tree can be, we think in terms of its utility, you know. We don't think in terms of gods. So they, for pain or something, you know, it is taken. Now it is being felt because there is a change, God will, then you know, they are all finding it difficult to have water there. And human habitation is slowly getting into the Himalayas, more and more. There are cluster houses. Not that everywhere it is spread, but clustered. But it is still, wherever you go, whenever we go, you know, we stay and then walk and walk and walk and sit on some rooftop and then, sorry, some hilltop and then watch the majestic views. And suppose we take a book like In Quest of God or anything like that, we are one with it. Papa is giving us a clue whenever we go, not necessarily Himalayas, any solitary place, anywhere where the Mother Nature has given her some bounteous gifts. Let's say hill stations people go, you know, rather than plains they go. But they find this. An untold joy, you know, we cannot explain what it is. We take photographs and show them. Even nowadays in the laptop. Screensaver. So many things come, you know. 99 out of 100 it is all, you know, the scenery. They ask you whether you like it. And if you like it, you know, they have taken so many photos. Where you find, you know, not human being, but nothing but nature and nature. Either it is a hill or it is a river. Or it's even if it's a dry place, it has got its own charm. Papa is asking us to think in terms of the expression of God, that is these three chapters. And we also found a test meted out by him, by the Bharadina. It was a test. Anybody who has walked so much and they have reached there, and when he sees the crowd, would be tempted, you know. The Panda, through Panda, Ram tested. Say that you are sick and get it. No. The more we think about it, we understand God stands for truth. So the means and the end should be same. Truth cannot be visualized by untruth. With untruth, we cannot go to the truth. We may be only seeing an idol there, that's all. But the real idol, no. Because it stands for truth. So, we did not compromise. Even though that was the biggest lesson, no? Vajina. And in Kedarnath, we found how the girl was saved. In Kedarnath we found how the old lady dropped her body. Same. O creator, protector, destroyer of the world. Jagatpadakan, Ashakartadu. All these things, you know, then only the reading becomes complete. And one, we have got 10 minutes, this morning, yesterday morning, because we find here one word of Papa, because we have not talked much. He says, he recalled you to Ram's grace whose name was on his lips. Now we are standing now. We were wondering. We used to say that we should know that we are chanting the name of one who is empty. Yesterday, when we were deeply going inside, on the first chapter, first he said, he introduced God as great one. Then he said, you know, the voice of Ram. Then he heard the, what was the message? Despair not, trust me, you shall be free. Then he made us to think elaborately about the word trust. Then after that, you know, there was conflict. The conflict has been beautifully brought out here, what a good hand in English. So the just one point of meaning. We're trying now. How the journey got started, from there we will start. The first glimpse of his presence was felt in the form of the voice from the great voice, which was named as Ram. The intensity of the mental struggle is portrayed through words like stormy waves of a raging sea. You know? It shows the intensity of the mental struggle. Intensity of the mental struggle is portrayed through words like in a stormy waves of a raging sea. But by the power of intense prayer, his grace got kindled. You are lying there, you know, crazy inside. It got kindled and resulted in blessing him with a pacifying experience in the form of a feeling of inexplicable relief. We cannot say what it was. In Papa's words, these encouraging words of Ram proved like a plank thrown towards a man struggling for very life in the stormy waves of a raging sea. The great assurance soothed the aching heart of helpless Ramdas like gentle rain on thirsting earth. So this feeling of calmness, you know, born out of a feeling of his presence. This is where, no? We are trying to raise ourselves to understand. Normally, suppose there is something there, we use some steps to, we are trying. Through experience we have to do it, but now we are trying to get a glimpse of that, what he has. With the help of the words, with the help of a bench or a stool, no? We are trying. The feeling of calmness, born out of a feeling of his presence, you know. What is his presence? A state wherein peace, serenity and the like is experienced. Chellamudiyathu fullness. Granted by him, encouraged him to retain the same. Reflecting on the presence of the giver of calmness and peace is named as meditation. That is how we look at it now. Because first he did not chant. Meditated and then first meditate. So what is that meditation means? Reflecting on the presence of the giver of calmness and peace, named as meditation, started slowly taking root in him. As an aid to meditation, chanting of his name also followed. Remembering him as much time as possible made the love for him intense. The repetitive performance. One important point is the chanting of his name got originated from within. This is what we wanted to share today. That is, it was not that somebody said you start chant. Ram, Ram. The whatever the inexplicable, the blissful state he was awarded with, he wanted to retain. And the process of retaining is called meditation. Later on we call it as attributes, you know. And as an aid for that, because he was still, you know, in the Vyavaharic field, so as an aid to that, he needed something to remind him of this, so he started chanting Ram. So that is why the chanting was so sweet, so effective to him, unlike us. We chant because somebody asked us to chant. Here it was an expression of his intensity to retain that pleasant moment, which he normally named it as sweetness. Think. So we must chant the name originated from us. Same Ram. So what is required is whether it is originated from us. How do we ensure that again we start a thing? It gets originated only when you know that he is initiating. That is why for all of us, Papa said, while chanting these two things you should remember that you are chanting the name of one who is seated within, and it is he who is making you to chant. It is not that somebody gave and you are chanting. It is he who is seated within you who is making you to chant. So the ownership of the name should be with us. Then only we will enjoy. It was a wonderful journey for us when we started going through that. Again we will kindly think about it. The first glimpse of his presence was felt in the form of the voice of the great voice, which was named as Ram. The intensity of the mental struggle is portrayed through the words like stormy waves of a raging sea. But by the power of intense prayer, it raised like darkness, got kindled, resulted in blessing him with a pacifying experience in the form of feeling an inexplicable relief, which he says, these encouraging words of Ram proved like a plank thrown towards a man struggling for very life in the stormy waves of a raging sea. The great assurance soothed the aching heart of helpless Ramdas like gentle rain on the thirsting earth. The feeling of calmness, born out of a feeling of his presence. Presence only? A state wherein peace, serenity and the like is experienced. Stillness, silence, bliss, anything we can add. Granted by him, encouraged him to retain the same. In our case, you know, we get a glimpse and other parts come. We get a glimpse, we get a ecstatic feeling, but there is no sustained effort to retain this. So in his case, God, Ram helped him, encouraged him to retain the same, to relive the same. Reflecting on the presence of the giver of calmness and peace. Reflecting on the presence of the giver of calmness. Because later on he will say, Ramdas, through a ceaseless repetition of the divine mantra, side by side with concentrated meditation on the all-pervading, eternal, ever-blissful, indwelling God had attained freedom and peace even before his advent into the world of the mendicants. Before he started on the 27th of December, no? He had developed it. This gave us the proof. That is why he said meditator. So the chanting was originator. Chanting was as an aid to meditation. As an aid to meditation, chanting of his name also followed. Because he says here clearly, thenceforward a part of the time that was formerly totally devoted to worldly affairs was taken up for the meditation of Ram, who for that period gave him real peace and relief. Gradually love for Ram, the giver of peace, increased. The more Ramdas meditated on and uttered his name, the greater the relief he felt. So whenever free from worldly duties, be the period ever so small, he would meditate on Ram and utter his name. Walking in the street, he would be uttering Ram Ram. So then a stage came when it was simultaneously going. No? First, he enjoyed a glimpse. Then to retain that glimpse, you know, he started chanting. Then chanting and this one simultaneously were going, and that he was able to get stabilized before he set foot on his inner life.
In each moment bringing Ram, Ram is the doer.
Ram, Ram, Ram. It was very clear. So as an aid to meditation, chanting of his name also followed. Remembering him as much time as possible made the love for him intense. One important thing is, the chanting of his name got originated from within. With the result, repetition of his name yielded a blissful state. Anything that is original is more powerful than what is obtained from the external source. That means chanting becomes effective only when it is always coupled with meditation. To ensure more and more concentration on the great giver, all forms of comfort and even major part of necessity was given up as prompted from within, not from any external factors or tradition. So we are again going through the first chapter. Because every time you will say sweetness, sweetness, sweetness. Every time. Sweetness, the moment you put it in a lozenge, Initiation. He says, Ramdas can tell you this much. From the very time he started repeating the name, he began to feel the sweetness of it. We were wondering, what is the sweetness? Nobody has got any clue to the sweetness. The present feeling, you know, that is what is called the presence of him is the present feeling. Then you become full, even if for a fraction of a second. Sweetness. Ramdas can tell you this much, that from the very time he started repeating the name, he began to feel the sweetness of it. So he used to pray to God, he does not want anything else, only he wants your name. Let your name be ever on his tongue, it is because it is so sweet. So it proved to be not a means to an end, but an end in itself. That is why he said the end in itself. The presence is felt, you know. This is the wonder about the name which he is repeating. Of course, it depends upon the repeater. Unless we are free from the low passions of the heart, we cannot taste the sweetness of the name. So it is relative, agreed? But this preparation was going on. No? How did he find the name sweet later on when he declared? Because it is now becoming clear, because it is always followed with or coupled with side by side. The presence of God is felt. Chanting on the outer way, chanting vocally, mentally or silently, it is an activity. But activity coming out from originator, that's why originator told him, coming out from the feeling of presence. This is not something new to any of us. On many days you say, you know, the Ram Nam was super. The only thing is, we are not aware that it has come from the origin. God blesses us with this experience. But now we know that those experiences or that feeling came not because of the sound, not because of anything else, but because he had opened up for a trice, for a few seconds, for a few minutes. And that at that time the Nama has come from the source, originated. Otherwise it comes from the surface level. And there is a joy at the surface level too. We go for a music performance, the artist sings. Suppose you have got a liking for a particular raga or song. When you ask her or request them to sing, you are thrilled for that moment, no doubt. Like that, there is. You remember when we attended, we used to attend whenever in Bangalore, Tata Yashmin, sorry, Bombay Sisters. So then we sent a chit, how many hands it has to go. Karadare Barabharade, it's a beautiful. When I call you, why don't you come, please? So then immediately when she sang, we still remember the way we are recruited, you know. It was in the 70s, but still remember. Karadare Barabharade. If I call you, why don't you knock? Why should you not knock, please? So when we write that, when they sing of your liking, you enjoy it, no doubt. But are you dwelling on it? Only one person, that person can. So here the Rama chanting, God gives, not only He has given us a habit to chant, to enjoy chanting, but after that, what happens? My other system of thinking, my norms, my approach, it is intact. Because I have not become aware that it has come from the origin. So now we all pray, being the votaries of Ram Nam, the enjoyers of Ram Nam, we are now praying to Him, give us that. You have facilitated everything. You make us to know that it is coming from You, who is seated within me. So these thoughts we thought we should share with you. And then tomorrow we move to Mathura. Yeah, Mathura. Mathura, Vrindavan are interesting. Raipur, Ajmer, so many interesting points will be there. Let us all try to retain as much as we can. 400 miles in 40 days He made us to cover in 30-40 minutes, but the impression it leaves is something more deeper and deeper. Let us not try to just wash it away. Let us try to retain us. Those who have gone to Himalayas will definitely see it in a different way now. Those who have not gone will try to go there with this background, with the book in question of God. so that we will really make use of our Hariyo. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ramavum, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ramavum, Yeah.